hearts to worship the memory of Jesus.
Thank you.
We are pleased to be gathered here in your house this morning, gathered with brothers and sisters in Christ, gathered to fellowship with one another, to worship you, to hear your word proclaimed, to be touched by the Holy Spirit and transformed into the very image of Jesus. That's why we're here, and that's our prayer this morning, that you transform us into the image of Christ. It's in his holy name that we pray. Amen.
Now we'll turn over to 728. Sorry, I had the wrong copy of the meeting. All four verses.
We confess them so that you are free to speak to us, and they're no longer in the way. They're no longer blocking that channel of communication. We confess our sins, Father. They vary from person to person, but each one here, beginning with me, each one here is a sinner who needs forgiveness. So we seek that forgiveness this very day so that we can be not only forgiven, but find victory over sin in the future so that we can become more and more and more like Jesus. And Lord, along that way, we pause and we want to lift up those who are hurting, We want to lift up those who are struggling physically, whether it's injury or illness. We want to lift up those that are struggling in relationships, those that are struggling financially. Father, whatever that struggle may be, we lift those folks up knowing that your grace is sufficient. Father, we not only lift them up, we lift us up, because it's we who stand in the need of prayer. It's we who are sick and injured and struggling in relationships with finances. It is us, Father, not merely some nameless person on a prayer list that we don't all know. It is us standing in the need of prayer. Help us, Lord, to always bring our needs to you. Not that you don't know our needs, but somehow bringing our needs to you brings comfort to our souls as we realize that you are there to help us. You are there to meet our needs. You are there to grant us what is best for us. And so we do that this very morning. We lift up all of those who are hurting, and we want to praise you that once again, this vaccine has started our chemotherapy treatment. It was a good experience. The sickness has not come, and you are in charge of taking care of her, and we praise you for that. And Lord, that's true for all of us. What is true for Maxine is true for us. You are taking care of us, and for that we praise you. Now, if you would, join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Jennifer this morning, it's found in Proverbs where it says, "The generous man will be prosperous, and he who waters himself will be watered. But if thou honor God." Every last thing on your agenda, we trust you to fund it. Father, I ask that you bless those who so faithfully have given, not only this day, but over the years that they've been connected to this congregation. They faithfully give because they understand that we cannot outgive you, because they understand that giving is becoming like you, and because they understand your desire, your heart for this congregation. Praise you, Father, for those who so thankful. In your holy name, I do pray. You may be seated, and the children can come forward in this.
You can
play on
the mustard. You are never too small in the eyes of God. If we can plant a mustard seed like that, you know, a tree big enough that the birds will come and sit in its branches, what do you think God can do for you?
God is a tree.
He helps it grow, okay? With the yeast, you know what he said about the yeast? He said, the kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and mixed in with 3 measures of flour until all of it was leavened. Okay? Basically means she made bread. Okay? That's what Jesus wants us to do, right? He wants us to be a part of his kingdom, to change the world around us and make it better. With just these little bitty pieces right here. You've got your little mustard seeds.
I don't want one.
And you've got your yeast. So just like the little mustard seeds, the ministry of God and the ministry of Jesus. Do you guys know how that started? It started very small with 12 disciples. That was it. Just 12 people started it. And look what happened. It's all over the world now, right? That's how God works in our lives, okay? The smallest amount can make the biggest difference. And I want you guys to remember that, okay? Just remember that you guys are important. You can make stuff when small things happen, right? Let's say Father, please help us to remember that size is not important in your kingdom. And you can see even the smallest of us. Help us to do good things in your most precious name. Be with us this week and bring us back all safe and healthy again next week. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Now if you'll stand and take your hymnals and turn to 700.
result of the absolute necessity of building our lives on the right kind of foundation. No matter what quality of materials we use, no matter how carefully we join the frame together, no matter how skilled our craftsmanship may be, if the foundation is not solid and stable, our house, and Jesus is really talking about our lives, but our house will lack structural integrity. This means that over time, not day one, but over time, cracks will develop in the walls, the windows will stick, the doors will not shut correctly, the roof will leak, and sooner or later, the storms of life will bring it crashing down, and everything we have worked so hard to build will be lost. Back in the early 2000s, the Leaning Tower of Pisa was reopened to the public after having been closed for almost a dozen years. And during that time, engineers completed a $25 million renovation project designed to stabilize the tower. And in so doing, they were able to reduce the lean of this famous tower by about 16 inches. Sounds like a lot when you're 16 inches out of plumb. It was barely a dent. You see, this was necessary because the tower had been tilting further and further away from the vertical for hundreds of years, to the point that the top of the tower was 17 feet further south than its base. 17 feet. $25 million brought back 16 of those inches. Nonetheless, the Italian authorities were concerned that if nothing was done, it would soon collapse. Now, what was the problem with the Leaning Tower of Pisa? Poor workmanship? An inferior grade of marble? No, the problem was what was underneath. You see, the sandy soil on which the tower was built was just not stable enough to support a monument of that size. In simplest terms, the tower did not have a firm foundation. It was not built on the rock. With all that said, I would ask you to please rise and bow your head in honor of God's word. It's recorded in Matthew chapter 7, verses 24 through 27. Again, these are almost the closing words of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. Jesus said, "Everyone then who hears these words of mine and acts on them will be like a wise man who built his house on a rock. The rain fell, the floods came, and the wind blew and beat on that house, but it did not fall, because it had been founded on a rock. And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not act on them will be like a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain fell, and the winds came, the floods came, and the wind blew and beat against that house, and it fell, and great was its fall." The word of God to the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Let's pray together. Lord, we come before you yet again. We ask you to speak to us this morning. Speak to us so clearly that we cannot misunderstand. If it's possible to use my words, please do so. If not, drown me out so that everything you have for us this day is clear and plain. In your holy name. Amen. You may be seated. You will notice that in our scripture for today, there are only two types of builders. When I read this passage out of the Methodist, it tells me that there's a smart carpenter and a stupid builder. That's your two choices, smart or stupid. Wise or foolish is what we traditionally know of. Those are two types of builders. When it comes to matters of ultimate truth, there are only two options. We're either trusting in Christ obeying his commands, following his example, or we are not. We're either following him or we are not. One way, the way of following Christ, leads to life and salvation. The other way, the not following Christ, leads to death and eternal destruction. I can sort of say what the message said, smart carpenter and stupid carpenter. If you're placing a choice between me, between life and death, I hope I'm choosing life, and I hope that you are too. Now, the world would have us to believe otherwise. The world says that there's a myriad of options on how to be in a relationship with God. In our culture, people, even people in the church, tend to follow a buffet approach to faith, to religion. They pick and choose elements from various traditions that they find personally meaningful. But God does not see it that way. According to the Bible, according to Scripture, there are not many ways to God, all of them more or less equally valid. That doesn't exist. Instead, there are only two ways: Christ and everything else. Two ways: Christ and everything else. One way leads to life, everything else leads to death. And most of the various religions and philosophies in the world contain at least a kernel of truth, something there that attracts followers. The problem is that the kernels of truth are mixed in with a great deal of falsehood. A great deal of falsehood. Sometimes that falsehood is obvious and easy to discern, and sometimes it is not. Excuse me. Regardless, every other approach to life will eventually lead us astray. It will betray us. It will make fools out of us. It will destroy us. And knowing Christ gives us everything we need to navigate our way through life, especially when we're in the midst of the storm and we don't know what to do next. Knowing Jesus gives us everything we need. There is nothing, absolutely nothing of spiritual value anywhere in this world which cannot be learned and experienced through Christ. It's a spiritual value that can be learned from him. He is completely sufficient. Completely. In our text today, the man who built his house on the sand did a lot of things right. A lot of things. I don't know how many of y'all have ever built a house before. I know at least one contractor is here in front of us today. But building a house is not an easy thing. It's not an easy thing. It probably took this man weeks, if not months, of back-breaking labor to build his house. Both men. We're talking about the man who built his house on the sand first. It took him a long time. He did not quit. He persevered until the structure was complete. Yet in the end, all of his hard work was for nothing. Fell down. Great was it destruction for nothing. Now I point this out because we often confuse activity around the church with godliness. Activity. Mostly we confuse just showing up with being godliness. But that's a mistake for us to do so. Because all that activity and service may be good. May be good. Foundation sin. That is, we could be doing all those things for all wrong reasons. It may not be obvious what those reasons are, just as it may not be obvious what kind of foundation is beneath the house, but in the end, the true motivation will become apparent. Even the most costly service and the most strenuous labors will not save us from the storms of life if the foundational motivation is not faithfully following Christ. Just works won't save us. Just works won't keep us in the midst of the storms. So what other kind of motivations are there? Well, pride, for one. Some people like to be involved in church activities because of the praise and recognition they received. Boy, you did a good job. I'm so thankful you did that. It was wonderful. I don't know, we may ask you to do that. We love that type of thing. Those folks like being in the spotlight. They like having people thank them and affirm their gifts. And this motivation is certainly not restricted to lay people. It includes pastors as well. How about self-righteousness as a motivation? Now, this one can produce some really exemplary workers in the church, but their primary reason for doing all the things they do is to earn God's favor and thus demonstrate to all around them that they deserve God's blessing. They deserve it. If you don't listen to anything else I say today, pay close attention to this sentence. It may set you a lot of heart. If you hear yourself complaining about how much you are doing around the church versus how little others are doing, then self-righteousness is somewhere in the mix. Let me say that again. If you find yourself complaining about how much you are doing around the church versus how little others are doing, then self-righteousness is somewhere in the mix. Our motivation is pure when we place our trust and confidence entirely in Christ, rather than in our own works or merit. Now please understand, I am not criticizing active service in the church. In fact, we need more of it. But I am suggesting that we examine our hearts. Why are we serving? Why are we doing what we're doing? The foundation of all that we do has to be love for Christ, or else in God's eyes, it has no eternal value. Let me put it another way. Anything you or I do that cannot be traced back to our love for Christ will eventually become worthless. Become worthless. Consider also that the house built on sand was a good, solid structure. One that from all outward appearances was well built. It did not fall down right away. It was not obviously defective. As long as the weather was good, it was perfectly adequate. Well, that's a deadly phrase, perfectly adequate. That's what we settle for in our lives, personal lives, family lives, and church lives, way too often. Anybody listening to me? That's perfectly adequate. That's good enough. No, it's not. Anyway, the house is perfectly adequate. It was not until the heavy rains and wind came that it collapsed. Now, I highlight this because just as the man's diligence was no sign he was doing the right thing, neither was the apparent success of his labors. Yes, he managed to accomplish something that looked impressive and worthwhile, but that did not mean that he was in good shape, because underneath it all, just waiting for the real storm, hidden weakness that was the lack of a firm foundation. It is possible. I wish it wasn't, but it is. It's possible to accomplish a great deal in this world without Christ. That's where we get the perfectly adequate from. It's possible to accomplish a great deal in this world without Christ. You can build a successful business or a career. Many lost people. You can make a lot of money, even be a billionaire. You can have a reasonably good marriage. You can develop a wide circle of friends. You can do good things. You can give money to charity. You can coach youth sports. You can volunteer at a nursing home. You can have a good time and enjoy life. You can do many big, important, impressive, and admirable things. But eventually, storms will come along, which will bring it all tumbling down. When the final storm of life comes, we know this storm is death. When the final storm of life comes, the only thing that will matter to me and to you is whether we are in Christ. Whether by faith we receive His forgiveness and His righteousness. If you have, then you will stand. If not, then you will be swept away into lasting punishment and destruction. Listen to what Jesus said about the ultimate judgment of humanity. And He said this in the verses preceding our text for today. He's closing down the Sermon on the Mount. He says, when the Son of Man comes in His glory, and all the angels with Him, then He will sit on the throne of His glory. All the nations will be gathered before Him, and He will separate people on one side from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And He will put the sheep on the right hand and the goats on the left. Then the King will say to those at His right hand, come, you are blessed by My Father. Inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. And He will say to those at His left hand, you are accursed. Depart from Me into eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteousness into eternal life. Wow. Jesus said that. Don't be mad at you. Do that again. There may be some here today. Don't know. Never know. There may be some here today who know themselves to be outside of Christ. And to you I say, stop building your life on stop. Quit. Now is the day. Prepare yourself for the storm of life, for that final storm which will sweep everyone and everything away that is not found in Christ. Turn from your sin. Place your trust in Christ's forgiveness of sins and eternal life. Do not delay a minute longer, because you do not know when that storm. All you know is that it will come, and it will be terrible for those without a firm foundation. You know how many houses stand that are built on sand when the storm comes? It's an easy number. Zero. You're not the exception. Your family's not the exception. Your grandkids are not the exception. No house will stand when the storm comes that's built on sand. Now, on the other hand, I know that most of you consider yourselves to be in Christ and are expecting that the final judgment will leave you standing. And I pray you're right. But still, I offer you this warning. Do not be complacent. You know, adequately sufficient. Do not be complacent. Do not assume that just because you're a member of the earthly church, you will be received by Him on that day. What matters to put your life demonstrates that a genuine change of heart has taken place. The change that comes through faith in Christ and is accomplished through the power the Holy Spirit. Again, immediately preceding our text today, Jesus said, not everyone who says to Me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. That'll make us nervous. Let me back up and read that again, and then I'll finish it. Not everyone who says to Me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of My Father in heaven. On that day, many will say to Me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and cast out demons in your name and do mighty truths in your name and show up and listen to bordering creatures in your name and sing in the choir in your name and take up offering in your name? Didn't I do all those things? And I will declare to them, I never knew you. Go away from me, you who believe who behave lawlessly. Make sure you're not deceived. I'm not judging anyone, I'm asking you to judge yourself. Make sure you are not deceived, that you do not claim to follow Christ, while in your heart you're following our own desires, your own desires and inclination. You're doing it your way. You've been inoculated with enough Jesus, you're hoping to be blessed with fire insurance at the end. But you're still living a life your way. Finally, let's look at the wise builder, the smart carpenter. Recall how Jesus describes him. Everyone then who hears these words of mine and acts on them be like a wise man who built his house on the rock. And acts on them. And acts on them. You know what happens to most of my preaching in your Bible study? We just read and gain or hear and gain little information and we go on. We need to act on what he told us. Jesus said, everyone who hears these words of mine and acts on them be like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain fell, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house. But it did not fall because it had been founded on the rock. Now, how did this man differ from the foolish man, the smart carpenter from the stupid one? Did he work harder? Most probably not. Did he use better building materials? Not necessarily. See, the only difference that Scripture points out, the only difference is in the foundation he chose to build upon. But that made all the difference in the world. Because he chose to build on the rock. Even the most terrible, frightful storm could not destroy his house. If we belong to Christ, if our lives are truly built upon faith in him and obedience to his commands, and fellowship with him through the Holy Spirit, then there is literally nothing, absolutely nothing that can separate us from God. The storms of life may rage, in fact, they most probably will. We may become frightened and fearful, and odds are, time and time, we will. We may even come close to despair, but no matter what happens, our faith cannot be destroyed. We cannot lose Christ or be lost by him. Listen to these precious promises of Scripture. First, from the Apostle Paul. No test or temptation that comes your way is beyond the force of what others have had to face. First of all, you're not alone. That's life. Then he continues. All you need to remember is that God will never let you down. He'll never let you be pushed past your limit. He will always be there to help you through it. And then this promise of Jesus. My sheep hear my voice. I know them and they follow me. And you did catch that, right? That's an action. They didn't just hear his voice and recognize it. They know me and they follow me. I give them eternal life and they will never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father, in regard to what he has given me, is greater than all, and no one can snatch them out of the Father's hand. The Father and I. How that is true. And then back to the Apostle Paul. I am convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love. Notice he didn't say nothing except. Nothing can ever separate us from God's love. Neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither our fears for today nor our worries about tomorrow, not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. No power in the sky above or the earth below, indeed. Nothing in all creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus our Lord. I don't know about you, those promises sound like a rock. Build our hearts. Lord, we come before you yet again, thankful for your promises, for your word, that you are the rock of our salvation, and that you have called us to you and promised to keep us with you. Help us, Lord, if we attempted to even add an addition onto our house, to our lives, that's on sand, to move away from it and only build on you in the holy name.
Stand and take your hymnals and turn to 734. Be strong in the Lord.
bless you and continue to bless you throughout this week. And I will remind our session that we have a meeting in the King Room here in just a few moments. With that said, receive now this benediction. Believe in the risen Jesus. And live accordingly by lining up all of your life on the rock, which is Christ. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.